Well, I just want to acknowledge the work that Melvin Teer and Jun Yu, who are the people in charge of the Siddiqui Poon Institute, have put into assembling the speakers and getting this conference ready today. So first of all, on behalf of SNU, and in particular the Lee Kong Chan School of Business, of which I'm dean, a tremendous welcome to SMU. If you haven't been here before, you now know it's the best management university in Singapore. And those of you who went to the competition will probably realize even better after today's event that it is the number one management university in Singapore. The purpose of the Sim Kee Boon Institute is, in the first instance, to honor Sim Kee Boon, the late Sim Kee Boon, who gave so much to developing the infrastructure of Singapore. But beyond that, a number of people got together with MAS to generate the finance for the Sim Kee Boon Institute. And its mission is to build financial research, and an acknowledgement of what goes on in the finance industry for both the academic community and, more importantly, the business community. So we really want to be seen not only as doing rigorous and relevant research, but research that has an impact practically on the issues that are arising in the asset management and the financial industry. And that's our purpose. Today's purpose is to have a half-day dialogue with you about those kinds of issues. I mean, this point of our lives is an interesting period, I would have to say, in the financial markets. For me, as a former rugby player, it's also a very interesting period because the Rugby World Cup is getting to a point of really quite interesting proportions. And for me, it's slightly more interesting than watching the dollar move up and down at the moment. In fact, those of you who can figure out my accent, I'm actually Welsh. And there's a very important game at the weekend between Wales and Fiji. And Wales have this habit of sliding on a banana skin and losing to the Pacific Island rugby teams. So I'm praying to anybody who will listen to me that we win by Sunday evening. If we don't, my colleagues, my staff, my faculty, and everybody else will see me in the Monday morning with a long face and probably snapping away at their heels to get things done. But I'm assuming all will be well. I also assume all will be well with the financial markets too. And I think part of our mission and part of the reason, as I said before, for doing these things is not simply to have a half-day conference, but for networking, for sharing information, and for presenting up-to-date research, both practical and applied, and theoretical, on the financial management and the asset management industry. You can see in front of you the topic of this conference. I think what we've done, and I welcome all the distinguished speakers who are here, my faculty colleagues and the students who are here, as well as the other guests who are here today. We have a tremendous lineup. Our moderator, Melvin Teo, is a professor of finance at the business school. And we also have a series of speakers. I'm sure they've been flashed up over there. I'm just going to take a piece of paper out just to make sure I remember who they are, just in case I forget anybody. Gerard Lee of Global Lion, Madeline Ho from Fidelity, Hugh Young from Aberdeen, Alex Ng from BNP, and Mark Dalton from Cambridge Associates. It's a huge welcome to all of you. I hope you enjoy the day. Please note that the conference is only half a day, not a whole day, so I think you'll have a good time because whole day conferences end up with people sliding off at lunchtime. You can have lunch and then slide off. So I hope you have a good time here today. I hope you network well, and I hope you enjoy the dialogue between the academics, the practitioners, and all of you during the course of the morning. So a huge welcome, and thank you very much for coming. Thank you.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I always enjoy coming to this auditorium. But as an alumnus of NUS, I wouldn't comment on whether this is the best management university in Singapore. the dean is no longer around, so I'm a devotee. Anyway, thanks Melvin for those very kind remarks, and Alex, who was sitting next to me, just whispered in my ear that, you know, actually what Melvin was saying is that you are quite old already. For someone who has done so many jobs in his life, obviously, you know, it's because I've been around for a while. Used to think that I'm still thinking I'm a very young person. I think this is a new normal. Those of you in the audience will agree with me that it doesn't really matter how long you work. In this day and age, because of the opportunities given us by technology, we are very well engaged in what's happening. The body may be fading away, but the mind is still as strong as possible. Anyway, today I have been given the liberty to speak on the topic of my own choosing with some broad guidelines given by Melvin. It's a topic that I'm very passionate about, and that is why is it that in our country, which is a small country known as the Little Red Dot and often punches above its weight, why is it that in asset management we have not been able to achieve the same? So that is really the bottom line of my talk, and I'm proposing some growth strategies. By no means these are the exhaustive strategies, these are mine, and I just want to share them with you. So I will open it up for you to give your comments, dispute me, and so on and so forth. And I am actually flashing quite a number of information in terms of data. Some of those data, I think, will be disputed by my competitors. But in order to prevent too much dispute, I just have got most of my information from two sources, from IMAS as well as from Accra. Okay, so with that as a preamble, let's begin. This is Singapore. This is what Singapore is well known for. Ferris wheel, we call them Singapore Flyer. Marina Bay Sands, you know, it's amazing. You know, Singapore is known for all the good virtues, but now Singapore's icon is actually a casino. But be that as it may, okay, it's doing us proud. And then of course, the most recently held event was the F1. You have the A380 plane with the Singapore logo in its tail. And that's probably the company that does most of us proud. Anyone who doesn't know Singapore, I bet you he knows Singapore Airlines, but not Singapore. And then of course, we've got the Durian, we've got the Merlion, we've got Capital O&M, Offshore Rigs, Raffles Hotel, and then finally, Command House. If you notice UBS, it's written down there. So these slides were actually prepared before the trading loss. Yeah? But anyway, this is Singapore. Open, inclusive, everything that is good about life. And let me get on with it. You know, this I have taken from the EDB website, basically listing the whole litany of awards that people have given to Singapore. Foreign Talent ranks Singapore as Asia's best country to work in. Singapore is ranked first for having the most open economy for international trade and investment. Singapore is the world's easiest place to do business. It's ranked the most competitive country in the world. It's the best environment in Asia Pacific and worldwide. How about the banking sector? OCBC, okay, which is the owner of Lion Global Investors, was ranked the world's strongest bank. Okay, we didn't make this claim ourselves, Bloomberg. Okay, yeah, it's not Straits Times, Business Times, or OCBC in-house publication, Bloomberg. Okay, and then most recently, Global Finance said these are the Asia's three top safest banks. Number one, DBS, OCBC, UOB. Okay, yeah. So even in banking, we may not be globally renowned, but this is what we are known for. Strong and safe. How about asset management companies in Singapore? Let's just look at the top 10, and then after that, I also want to show you where DBS AM and UOB AM are ranked. in the context of Singapore. So I've shaded the three bank-owned asset management companies, just to give you a sense. These are the top 10. Out of the top 10, only Lion is number 4. Okay, only Lion make it to the top 10, and we are number 4. And we are number 4 not because we have raised a lot of AUM. I'll be very honest with you. Without the assets from Great Eastern Life, we wouldn't be number 4. We will probably be, you know, in the same region as DBS, and we will be. So there's something systemic going on here. But the people who are actually leading the pack, Aberdeen, Templeton, UK, AIA, Morgan Stanley, UBS, Schroders, Nomura, and Principal. What you will notice here, besides the fact that Singaporeans are not very well represented, is also the fact that amongst other Asian-owned AMCs, there's only one other that makes it to the top 10, and that's Nomura, number 9. And that's because Nomura comes from a very, very big country. Again, there's something quite systemic happening here. Next, I just want to share with you the top providers of unit trusts in Singapore, not by AUM, but rather by the number of funds they have. You could dispute with me that you know, it's very easy to just raise a fund and put it on the shelf. So some people could have 100 funds and not selling anything. But by and large, I've done my homework. The people who have more funds usually can raise more AUM. So leading the pack is Schroders with 92 funds. BNP Paribas, 83, Fidelity, Templeton, UOB, Allianz, and so on and so forth. Okay. So of the two local houses, UOB and Lion, have within the same ballpark, 50 and 42. Next, we look at headcount, how many people we employ. Headcount is a good indication, obviously, of the size of the business, how successful you are at raising AUM, but more importantly, how profitable you are. Because if you are already a mature business like most of the Singapore-owned AMCs, we have been around for a quarter century, you know, it's no longer just initial capital, you know, we are going concern. So the one with the most number of staff is Pru UK with 262, followed by Schroders slightly above 200, Aberdeen at 160, next my own company at 140, Templeton 108, Fullerton 105, UOB 104, DBS 90, and then 86 for Capital and 66 for UBS. And then we match that against the AUM, and this is where, you know, it's often subject to dispute because figures go up and down. I got it from IMAS Directory of 2011. You see that based on AUM, the top guys here, okay, would be Aberdeen at 73, okay, and Templeton at 50. And then on the right column, this is looking at productivity, AUM per staff. Yeah. So the people who do very well here would be Templeton, yeah, and Aberdeen. At, you know, each staff manages more than $400 million. And then UBS is also pretty big. And then you see that at the bottom end of the loop would be our local owned asset management houses. All right? And I did qualify that Lion is where it is, mainly because of the parent company's money. So you see that if you actually do not have the AUM, you actually don't enjoy the productivity. And this is actually quite key. Next, let's look at another statistic. And here I take a look at the top 10 AMCs in the world and ask whether they have a Singapore office. So this is taken from Pensions and Investments. So the top 10 in the world: BlackRock, State Street, BNY Mellon, Fidelity, Vanguard, Kimpo, JP Morgan, Mundi, Legg Mason, and AXA. You see that all of them have offices in Singapore except BNY Mellon. And I was told that BNY Mellon is in the midst of getting a asset management license for them to set up the office in Singapore. So in due course, all the top 10 will be in Singapore. So you can see how world-class this business is and how actually competitive it is. And this is where, you know, I think the problem lies. Huh? in why the Singapore own AMC is finding some difficulty in trying to act within character of other aspects of Singapore life, where we are so used to being the best. If not the best, number two, number three, okay, always within Division One. But in asset management, we have a problem. And this is one of the main reasons. So I talk about the benefits of economy of scale, AUM per headcount. I talk about the fact that it's so globally competitive because almost the top 10 in the world are here in Singapore. So let me introduce something else, cost to income ratio. You can see that the guys who manage a lot of AUM, their cost to income ratio are a lot lower. So Aberdeen cost to income ratio is only at 34, Templeton at 38, and you see that they have the highest AUM. Next is my company at 49, AUM per staff is 157, okay? And then you just go down the line and you see that actually there are a couple of firms with high AUM per staff, Fidelity as well as Prudential, okay? But despite that, their cost to income ratio is pretty, pretty high. So one can only conclude that the staff are very, very well paid, yeah? Okay? And then when you look at Lion, okay? Yeah? Despite the lack of AUM per staff, my cost to income ratio is still very low. You can only conclude that my staff are very badly paid. That's just a joke, okay? And then obviously net profit before tax, you can see the difference, all right? Yeah, when you don't have the scale, your cost to income ratio is pretty high, and that's because your AUM per staff is very low, and that shows up in the net profit before tax. So in the case of DBS and UOB, you can see very, you know, this is what it is. And just to get how long the three local bank-owned companies have been around, Lion has been around for 25 years, UOB AM has been around for 25 years, and I believe DBS Asset Management has been around for either 27 or 29 years. So, you know, by no means are we startup, by no means are we still infants. We've been around for a long time, yeah, and yet we have this problem. So what does the media say about Asia? You know, just to set the context going forward. The good news is very good. Asian equities received 100 billion through mutual fund flows in 2010, according to research from New York-based Strategic Insight. The bad news is that very little of this is being captured by Asian mutual funds. The lion's share is to funds domiciled in the United States, Europe, and other locales. Yeah. So, although people are very, very willing to invest their money into Asia, especially over the last 10 years, and more recently in the last 3 years after the GFC. But the fact is that you know, the money that is coming to our region, to our backyard, our indigenous firms are not reaping the benefits because someone else is eating our lunch. Yeah? So that's according to Asian Investors report on the 5th of July of this year. Now let's look at my favorite source, Bloomberg. What does it say about Singapore? Singapore will become the world's top wealth management center by 2013 because of emerging markets growth and as new rules put pressure on Switzerland and London, PwC said in a new study. All right. So this is setting the stage for a growth strategy. If Singapore is going to be the biggest wealth management center, even if that doesn't happen, logic would suggest that we are probably number two, number three, number four, at most number five, right? Worst case scenario. So that being the case, that presents opportunities. And then one other thing people say about Asia is something that obviously came about after I prepared the slides, came from CLSA Strategies, Russell Napier, last week in Hong Kong. CLSA has its annual forum, the one held in Hong Kong, is the biggest of the whole series of forums they have, they hold. And according to Russell Napier, in the current investment environment, because of the volatility and the fact that people have lost so much money and getting whipsawed all the time, there are only two safe havens. And the first safe haven is the Singapore dollar. The next safe haven is gold. So, gold, we know how much it's gone up, and if Singapore is a safe haven, that means Singapore equities will be demanded. Singapore fixed income will be demanded, both government securities as well as corporate securities. Singapore dollar obviously would continue in its ascent, and so the secular appreciation, I think, will carry on for a long time to come, until most recently, when investors started taking profit, or actually had some bouts of panic regarding their investments in Asian currencies, they begin to dump. So the Sing dollar moved from 120, or dollar Sing moved from 120 to 130. But besides that, I think for most of us, the issue is how long would it take before the Sing dollar trades at parity with the US dollar? Okay, so not, that's probably something to, SMU may want to organize to have a context. For me, it's probably one big figure per month. So to move from now 130 to 1.00, 30 months. So within 2.5 years, one Singapore dollar will buy one US dollar. Yeah? So if you want to buy things from the US, don't buy it. So how do Singapore owned AMC stack up? We started our asset management business in the early 90s. While the foreign owned AMCs came mostly after the AMAS began promoting Singapore as an asset management center, and most of that happened in the 1990s, when the AMAS organized its own version of the EDB, meaning it sets up a It sets up a department that promotes Singapore aggressively. Yeah? So that's just to set the context of how the landscape is in terms of the arrival of the AMCs. But after 20 over years, we have relatively low AUM, and low AUM leads to low AUM per staff, and that obviously leads to high cost to income ratio. So why are the local firms lagging? We may have a head start in Singapore, but in the global context, we are still under. And that is one of the reasons why I decided that I should move from Fullerton to Lion, because Lion, being the biggest in Singapore, I think deserves to be better known globally. So I'm passionate about bringing Lion global. Secondly, we are competing from the world's best. I've just shown you the top 10 in the world are in Singapore. No other business, no other sector in Singapore, you have to compete with the world best. Assuming if today Harvard Business School, Yale, Chicago, Stanford, UCLA, all these guys are in Singapore, they're not there. Obviously, SMU won't be your first choice, all right, when you want to apply. I mean, I say as a matter of fact, yeah, okay? Neither is NUS. Neither is MTE. Okay? Yeah? If Harvard Business School, Chicago, and all these guys are here, you will apply for them first. Only if you are rejected by them, then you'll come to SMU. Okay? Yeah? Anyway, business development, unfortunately for the local owned AMCs, have been focused primarily on Singapore and Southeast Asia. Okay? So while that's a natural thing to do after 20 over years, you could go further afield. You shouldn't just still be crawling. You should be walking and running and flying by SIA. One of the other things, unfortunately, is that although Asian is a desired destination, and therefore, if we manufacture Asian products, that should be music to our ears. But the world of investing is actually very strangely organized. People invest either in the developed world, developed markets, or the emerging markets. In emerging markets, people allocate money as a block. They don't allocate to it in the sub-block. So emerging markets typically would mean Asia, Latin America as well as in Eastern Europe, and more lately MENA, Middle East, North Africa. Okay. So that becomes a handicap for us because the local owned AMCs mostly just manufacture Asian products, and we don't have the other parts of emerging markets. Okay. And then finally, we have not tapped into the presence of top private banks in Singapore yet. 20 years ago, maybe only 5 private banks in Singapore. Today, the top 40 private banks are in Singapore. Yet, the local players have not actually capitalized on this phenomenon. So what should the local firms do? In my opinion, we should sell to where the demand for Asian product is. And this is where a lot of people got wrong. We position ourselves as Asian specialists. So we manufacture Asian products and we sell to Asians. So that's fine. But the big demand out there for Asian products doesn't come from Asia. It's coming from the developed world, meaning US, Europe, and Japan. So we've got to go west and we have to go north. Next thing is that if we want to sell to these people, we have to be world-class. So what does being world-class mean? It means that you need to employ high-caliber people. So you have to get the first P, be willing to pay up, all right? Yeah. And then next thing, your investment process must be world-class. Just because you're able to beat your benchmark and select all the good stocks, it's not enough. People want to know whether the process is rigorous, whether the process is robust, whether it's repeatable, and whether you can actually handle the risk. And next is your performance has got to be good. That is a given. And then finally, you need to focus on the products that people really want. Yeah. So you need to go to the market to find out what is it that people want. Very often, those of us in the business, we sit in our office and we figure out that this is what people should want, and if people don't want, we say that they have to be educated. So we spend a lot of money educating people. Okay? Yeah. I mean, if people don't want to eat ice cream, they don't want to eat ice cream. They don't want to eat ice cream during winter. You know what I mean? Yeah? Why are you going to sell ice cream during winter? Things like that. Yeah? Next thing is that we have to consider mergers and acquisitions with firms in China, Japan, and some Western firms. I say that because obviously about a year ago, Nikko Asset Management bought into DBS AM. So that's a strategy. Okay? You either be the big fish in a small pond or you want to be a small fish in a big pond. So that's a decision that we all have to make. And my contention is that the Japanese feel that they're not as good at managing asset management on a regional basis than the Singaporeans, so they are prepared to actually merge with us. So obviously, as owners of Singapore AMC, we will make a decision on whether we are willing to give up our franchise or not. And by the same token, my expectation is that the Chinese AMCs, after having been in business now for about 12 years, the top 10, they have very big and large balance sheet. They have set up offices in Hong Kong to manage non-Chinese money. After doing that for 3 years, most of them have not achieved very much. I think the shareholders will get impatient. So within the next couple of years, maybe 2 to 3 years, they will start identifying targets to swallow up. And then obviously, there are a lot of Western firms who actually do not have presence in Asia. So they may also want to take a stake in some of us. And then the next thing is that we have to take advantage of Singapore's position as a top private banking center. And then one other thing in terms of manufacturing. We have to develop a world-class Greater China capability, both in equities as well as in fixed income. And a lot of people will dispute with me as to whether, based in Singapore, we can develop a capability because it belongs rightfully to Northeast Asia. The Chinese will be the best, and next, those in Hong Kong. If not, those in Hong Kong should be better off than those in China. But why should it reside in Singapore? Now, geographical proximity, fortunately, is not the most important thing in actually developing capability. If that were the case, you wouldn't be able to find a lot of good US equities managers in London and vice versa. There are a lot of good European managers in the States. So this is a big thing. Greater China is a big thing. Demand for China assets is a big thing because the RMB, the renminbi, is going to be a reserve currency. It's not a question of when, but a question of when. So when a currency becomes a reserve currency, you know the demand for its underlying asset. So since you know that that is going to be the tsunami that's coming, okay, take advantage of it. Build a world-class capability today. Yeah? And then finally, for the local AMCs, I contend that we should not just look at the public markets, we should look beyond the public market. So for example, private equities, real estate and infrastructure, in particular real estate. In particular, Asian real estate, Singapore real estate. So in conclusion, the local firms are lagging. Despite several advantages, we have a head start in this business, but we are still lagging behind. Singapore-owned AMCs have pan-Asian capability versus other Asian-owned AMCs that have not. Those in China have not. Those in Taiwan have not, Korea, and so on and so forth. Okay, the only other location where AMCs have pan-Asian capabilities is Japan. But in Japan, because I think of language handicap that they have, they find it very difficult to sell to non-Japanese customer. And scale is very important. In Asia, studies have shown that the top 10 AMCs, they take 80% of the pie. Yeah? And then we know that it's a very competitive industry, but the new world for us is that Singapore is the top private banking center, so we have to take advantage of that. So the question really is, can we punch above our weight? Okay. These are by no means the solutions I am putting forth before you. These are some of the strategies that we have to think about. Thank you for listening.